Gentlemen, it's 7 o'clock. I'd like to call the Common Council of the City of Hudson to order for Monday, August 17th. Please join me in the Pledge of Allegiance.
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Madam Clerk, the roll, please.
Mayor Burchill.
Here.
District 1, Morissette.
Here.
District 2, position is vacant. District 3, McCormick.
Here.
District 4, Weber.
Here.
District 5, Hoggett.
Here.
District 6, Hall.
Here.
This time in our agenda, we ask anyone in the audience that would like to speak to the council to come up, that's not on the agenda, to come up now and speak and ask questions or make comments to the city council. Is there anyone here that would like to speak to the council? Seeing none, we'll move on to discussion, possible action on consent agenda. Madam Clerk.
To approve the regular meeting minutes of August 3rd, 2015. To approve claims for payment in the amount of $609,295.95. A detailed description is available in the clerk's office on request and is posted on the city's website. Contingent on payment of any outstanding debt owed to the city and approval by the police department, approve the issuance of one regular operator's license for the period August 18th, 2015 to June 30th, 2017, and two temporary operator licenses for use September 18th through 20th, 2015 at St. Pat's Fall Festival event. Additional application information is available in the clerk's office on request. To approve Class B beer and Class B wine license application for the St. Patrick's Parish for the St. Pat's Fall Fest, September 18th through 20th, 2015, including the lower level of the social hall and lower parking area as proposed. To approve installing a yield sign on 4th Street at Division Street. To approve the St. Pat's Fall Fest 5K Fun Run Walk on Saturday, September 19th, 2015 at 9 a.m. beginning and ending at the Hudson High School. To place on file the city clerk's quarterly report and the monthly report of the finance officer. That is all.
Move for approval.
Is there a second?
Second.
Roll call.
McCormick?
Yes.
Hoggett?
Yes.
Weber?
Yes.
Hall?
Yes.
Morissette?
Yes.
Okay. Planning Commission, discussion, possible action on final development plans for Grand Stay Hotel and Suites, Hudson LLC, 70-unit hotel and conference center, 2101 Badger Drive. Mr. Darnold.
Good evening. The Grand Stay Hotel and Suites is proposing the old visitor center. It'll be on the west side, just located east of the large stormwater pond. So it'll be west of Badger Drive and north of Crestview Drive. Again, as the mayor mentioned, it'll be a 70-unit hotel and a 200-seat event center. Staff and Planning Commission recommends approval of the final development plans for the Grand Stay Hotel and Suites, 2101 Badger Drive, including the off-street access and utilities. There's some minor plan changes submitted to staff today, and so we want to add that it'll be contingent on staff approval of the modified plans or amended plans. And also there'll be some off-site utility work, and we want to provide an estimate of that utility inspection cost to the developers so that they have that. But recommend approval of those conditions.
We have people here.
Yeah, Mike Hafer from Project Architects here tonight, if you want to have a brief presentation.
Or if you have any questions based on the information that you have in your packet, or on your computer rather than in your packet.
Yeah, there's no direct access to Crestview Drive, right? That's
correct. There would be an emergency access on the southwest corner of the parcel. We want that to make sure that if the other access is plugged or blocked for some reason, that we'll have secondary access into the site. We should have a tertiary access in through other parcels. They'll be east of the site, but at that time those plans aren't submitted. But as we review those, we'll be looking at that provision.
I'll move for approval to move it along based on
staff and committee recommendation and contingent upon Denny's review of the latest plans.
Okay, is there a second?
Second.
Discussion? Comments? I think this looks like a great project, another hotel coming into town. It's a good location, and we are happy to have you in town. I guess we have to vote first before I... But all in favor?
Aye.
Opposed? Now, John, we're happy to have you in town and welcome. It's a good project. Next thing on the agenda, we have discussion, possible action on heritage of Hudson, 13 single-family or one-family lots, Heritage Greens, PRD, Creative Homes and Construction Investment, LLC.
In March of 2015, Common Council approved an amendment to the Planned Residential Development Conditional Use Permit for Heritage Greens Planned Residential Development. This will create 13 one-family lots on the east side of Heritage Boulevard between Heritage Boulevard and State Trunk Highway 35. There will be some modifications to the water system and the public water system in Heritage Boulevard, and also some sewer improvements. Plan Commission recommends approval of the final plat of Heritage of Hudson, 13 one-family lot residential lots and one outlot as proposed by Creative Homes Construction Investments, LLC, with the condition that a restrictive use agreement be prepared to address the issue of public sanitary sewer main located in the street right-of-way for lots 1 through 13 and part of the front yards or lot area of lots 12 and 13 with approval of the restrictive agreement by the city attorney before the plat may be recorded. I did discuss this issue of the restrictive covenants with the city attorney. Basically, we'd use the agreement the city currently has with property owners. The reason this requirement is typically sanitary sewer goes in underneath the improved portion of the city street under the drivable areas. Here, we're having to retrofit the existing system and we're going to tear Heritage Boulevard out completely at a much higher cost. We'll put the sanitary sewer in the Boulevard area. What we want to try to avoid is any misunderstanding by the property owners that, you know, that's part of their yard, they can do anything in it. So, you know, we'll put them on notice that there's a sanitary sewer line there and there'll be restrictions upon which they can do in that specific area. Again, there was some minor plan modifications submitted at the pre-construction conference this morning. So we want to add the condition of staff approval. And then again, estimates of the city inspection costs.
Is there a motion to approve?
So moved.
Is there a second?
Second.
Questions? Comments? We have someone here that can answer any questions.
Mr. Todd Erickson, yep. Representing, he's a project engineer representing Creative Homes, is here tonight.
So the sanitary will run through the whole boulevard, the entire project, or just part of it on the one end?
Well, yeah, basically the full length,
okay.
Correct?
Mm-hmm.
You have to understand that these lots were originally set up as two commercial or two multiple family lots, so there is only this. The sanitary sewer actually is on the farther side, on the west side of the street, and there's only two, so to try to provide sanitary sewer again without tearing up the whole street, they're going to run the sanitary sewer in the Boulevard area.
That makes sense.
Any other questions? Comments? Okay, all those in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Opposed? Motion carries. Thank you, Denny. Yeah. Discussion and possible action on requesting reallocation existing park capital project funds. Mr. Zuli? Or did I skip over something?
Subconsciously skipped.
I did.
Yeah.
All right.
Sorry.
I will go to finance. The our Nancy has submitted a letter of resignation as of December 4th, 2015.
Retirement.
And I believe it's with not a heavy heart, but happy for her that we accept that resignation, and that Devin has asked us for permission to go out, and we've got a new job description or a job description there, and we advertise to replace that position, which I think is it's critical and it's statutory, correct? So is there a motion to approve?
So move.
Is there a second?
I'll second.
Discussion. We'll have more, as we get a little further down, we'll have some more highlights after 26 years.
I personally just want to say thank you for your service, especially done a great job, but thanks for the long notice.
Yes.
That's much appreciated.
We had a discussion at that department head meeting after our short notices we received earlier in the year, and so we do appreciate that, so we have time to. The applications will be due back September 30th, so finance and personnel can discuss how they want to.
Okay.
Who they want to serve on the interview committee.
Okay. Anything else you want to add, Devin?
Nope.
Okay.
I tried to talk, we could change it to December 4th, 2016, which would get us through all the next year's elections, but I don't think Nancy's going to go over that.
All those in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Opposed? Motion carries. Now, Tom, discuss and possible action on requesting to reallocate existing park capital for project funds.
For the 2015 pathway improvement project, we had money allocated for Prospect Park, Lakefront Park, and Grandview Park. We're not asking for any more funding. We're just asking for the finance committee and the council to shuffle the funding around so we can get our project complete this year.
Transfer, not shuffle.
Transfer.
Shuffle sounds bad.
Okay.
But the finance committee recommended approval.
I'll move to approve.
Is there a second?
Second.
Any discussion, questions? All those in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Motion carries. Thank you. Next item on the agenda is the discussion, possible action on bids for Burton Field Warming House and Bath Remodel and to reallocate existing park capital funds for this project. Mr. Zuli.
Yes, thank you. The Burton Park Warming House remodel, just for general information, was done entirely by in-house staff. Special thanks to David Gray and Rhett from the building inspectors to do the plans and specifications. Just in general, this project will involve demolition and remodeling of the bathroom and the warming house located at Burton Field. The demolition will require the removal of an existing flat roof and some concrete sidewalks along the exterior of the buildings, along with some interior partitions and their associated plumbing and electrical components. Also involved will be removal and replacement of a number of existing windows and doors. Both buildings will be have a insulated wood truss system with the addition of insulation on the walls, exterior walls for energy efficiency. Revised plumbing and bathroom fixtures along with new concrete flatwork at the building's exterior will ensure ADA compliant access. New paint will be applied to the interior surfaces. The exterior of the building are also to receive new paint on the block walls, while the hardwood siding and fiberglass shingles will have lifetime warranty. Updated drinking fountain and exterior LED lights will also be installed.
You putting electric locks on it?
I'm sorry?
Electric locks for the doors?
We will be, anything that we could salvage, and that was part of the bidding process, will be used. So we currently have the automatic locking systems, which will be reused.
Okay.
Bids were submitted, put out in the Hudson paper for 2 weeks. We did receive two bids, one from Skyline Renovations for $110,558 for the base bid, and one from Braden Construction for $118,700. To lower the cost of the base bid, we submitted several options for deducts that the Public Works crew could possibly do. We did take advantage of option 19, 22, and 33, which were the interior, exterior painting, along with the concrete work on the outside of the warming house and restrooms. That deducts came to, I'm sorry, I thought it was about
$6,000?
About a little under $6,000. So The total project should be $104,608.
Is there a motion to approve?
So moved.
Is there a second?
Second.
Discussion, questions? Tom has assured me that there is no more projects. The $500,000 is not coming next year?
I think that was actually, I think that was a motion at one of the council meetings that...
I think it was.
I think it was.
Okay. You guys have done a good job on this. Gotten a good, I think we're getting a good bang for a buck for that area. So, questions anyone have? All those in favor?
Aye.
Opposed? Thank you, Tom.
Thank you.
Motion carries. Unfinished business, discussion, possible action on Resolution 18-15, resolution authorizing the call of the 2008 City of Hudson promissory notes. Neil, are you taking this? Or Sean? Welcome, Sean.
Thank you, Mayor. Thank you, Council. Mayor, I don't know if it would be a problem, but I may suggest that we do the next item first.
Not a problem.
Okay, only because if we didn't approve the refunding issue, we would not
have the reason to do the call. So I'll change that to discussion and possible action on Resolution 19-15. Resolution approving the issuance of 713,000 general obligation promissory notes series 2015C.
Great. Thank you, Mayor. Thank you, Council. I believe that Neil distributed the sale day report to everyone. I was at the last meeting and we talked about the opportunity to refinance the 2008 promissory note issue that was outstanding and has a call date of December 1 of this year. And what we looked at in discussing options with Neil was on an issue relatively small, 713,000, and 3 years left on it, three payments in 2016, 17, and 18, that we would put it out for proposals to local and regional banks in the area. And if I can have you all go one page in to the bid tabulation page, we'd sent it to a number of the area and regional banks, and ended up getting four bids, and they came in on Friday afternoon. For preliminary purposes, in the pre-sale report, we had estimated an interest rate of about 2%, or 2% exactly, in fact. And so if you look at the bids today, three of the four bids came in lower than that, with one a little bit higher than that. The best bid was from First American Bank, and it would be a fixed interest rate of 1.544% over the next 3 years. And again, compare that to what our pre-sale report that the council reviewed, about 2%. Now, the purpose of this, and if you go to the last exhibit, there's really just the one single purpose, which is to pay off the old issue and refinance it at lower interest rates to achieve less payments over the next 3 years. In the pre-sale report with the 2% rate, we had estimated savings would be somewhere in around, I think it was about $16,500. With the results and the best bid from First American, if you look in the blue rectangle box, I don't know if it's in color or not.
Not in color.
Yeah, it's this one right here. You'll see with the proposal from First American, the savings are projected, or not projected, would be finalized at $22,307. So a good improvement over the pre-sale from a couple of weeks ago. What would be needed this evening from the council to accept that bid from First American is a resolution that was prepared by the bond council. Approval of the resolution accepts the bid from First American and locks into the results that I just reviewed with the council. But before taking action on that, Mayor or Council, if there's any questions, I'd be happy to try to answer those.
Questions from any council person?
Move to suspend the rules.
Okay. Is there a second?
Second.
Okay.
Hall?
Yes.
Hockett?
Yes.
Weber?
Yes.
McCormick?
Yes.
Morissette?
Yes.
Is there a motion to resolution number 19-15?
I'll move to approve resolution 19-15.
Okay, is there a second?
Second.
Any discussion? All those in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Opposed? Motion carries. Next, we have, tell us about resolution 18-15, John.
Yeah, Mayor, with that first step out of the way, the issue that's outstanding from 2008, as I'd mentioned, the prepayment date is December 1st coming up. We are required per the covenants of that issue to provide the bondholders at least 30-day notice that we will be prepaying them and paying the final three payments on that off on the December 1st, 2015 call date. So approval of that, the next resolution up authorizes sending out that call notice to the existing bondholders, which will clear the way for us to make that payment on December 1st of this year.
I'll move to suspend the rules.
Is there a second?
Second.
Roll call.
Hockett?
Yes.
Weber?
Yes.
McCormick?
Yes.
Morissette?
Yes.
Hall?
Yes.
Move to adopt resolution 18-15.
Is there a second?
I'll second.
Is there discussion? Are there any questions? Sean, is there any prepayment penalty on this for us at this time?
No. As soon as we get to that December 1st date, Mayor, we're allowed to prepay with the outstanding principal plus accrued interest, but we'll have paid up on December 1st with the regularly scheduled payment, but there's no penalty.
Thank you. All those in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Opposed? Motion carries. All right. Thank you.
Yep. Thanks, Mayor. Thanks.
Discussion, possible action on library funding in the joint library agreement. We have the 2008 agreement and the 2013 amendment. We also have in the audience today the president of the Hudson Joint Library, Rich O'Connor. And Rich, do you want to say a few words about what's going on at the joint library at this time? I don't know if you knew that I was going to ask you to speak, but
I wasn't sure, and I sure didn't think I'd be leading off. But Mr. Mayor and council members, I appreciate the opportunity to come here today. The library, I don't know that I've been here in a while really to talk about the library, and just want to let you know that I think everything is going very well. I think that everybody's pretty much aware of the controversy that we've had over the past several years. That for the most part has evaporated. We had discord there for a while, and I think that was widely known, and that has also dissipated. Everybody's getting along. I think that we've done a great job in reining in our expenses and trying to get our budget under control. Not that it was out of control, but certainly we had to meet the revenues that were coming in, and we wanted to try to get to a budget where we were not in the red, and it took us a while to do that. And just as we did that, and of course one of the tools we used to do that was what you're discussing today, but just as we did that, all of a sudden now we have the issue before us where there's going to be potentially punitive action on the part of the county board to penalize us for the action that we took to stop making payments using our taxpayer money to fund additional library systems outside of our own. I don't know, I mean, I could go on for quite a while on this. I think that there are a number of things that I think need to be pointed out. First of all, the hearings that were held at the county, nobody from the library board was invited, nobody from the library was invited. But, as I understand, there were plenty of people that were coming from the other library systems that apparently have been affected by the decision to not make those payments. This was a decision that was obviously well thought out on the part of our board, and in pursuing our goals as fiduciaries, and I think that's very important, as fiduciaries we have a responsibility to our taxpayers, period. We must do what is in their best interest, and what we did was decided not to alienate taxpayer dollars by sending that money out to other library systems and instead support our own library system. Essentially, what we were doing is we were probably the only library system in the entire state of Wisconsin that was supporting additional library systems outside of our own. We didn't think that that was appropriate. We didn't think that it was in keeping with our fiduciary duty, and we felt that we needed to make sure that the taxpayer dollars were spent here in our own areas. I think that's probably the most important piece. The part about the 70%, I think is pretty important as well. I don't, you know, when you have a segment of government that is more than willing to be punitive, to penalize another one, that's something that everybody better think about. That's a precedent that's being set that I don't think is a very good one. And it certainly lends itself to discord at the county, as well as in between county board members, I would suspect, as well as discord between the units of government that make up the county. I would recommend that we continue down this path. And I would say this, I've had a lot of experience in government and even outside of government. And when you have somebody that's holding that hammer over your head, that hammer doesn't necessarily go away. And if we do everything we can to bring that funding level back to 100%, and believe me, I would love to see it at 100%, chairing the board and speaking on behalf of the board, but it means that at any point in time, if we do go back to the 100%, at any point in time, that board can come back and say, we're gonna take 30% for some other action. And the bottom line is they can never go below the 70% by law, but they certainly can do what they choose to do to penalize us if they feel that we're not acting the way they would like us to act. And in this case, we're acting in accordance with our fiduciary responsibility and what's best for our taxpayers and the citizens of our communities. I would also say this, on the political side of this, we've seen some pretty divisive issues, some issues that for the most part can be 50% one way, 50% the other. We certainly have seen what happened when the dog track was brought here. It was a 50-50 proposition, and that kind of changed from year to year, 51-49 one way, 51-49 another way. Same thing happened with using the vacant dog track now for a new school. You know, it can be a 50-50 issue. And you have to go back to your constituents and say, you know what, I did what I thought I was right, knowing doggone well that you alienated about half of your constituency, but you did what you thought was right. A wise sage mentor of mine once told me, in politics, your friends come and go, but your enemies accumulate. And what I would say is this, anybody in our municipalities that votes to send that money back to those other library systems will be voting against 100% of your constituency. Not 50%, not 40%. You will be voting against 100% of your constituency. And I hope you don't do that.
Questions for, sorry, Rich, are you, any questions for Rich? I just thought, has the president of the library get a different read than we had last time?
No, I thank you. I think you said it very eloquently, and I don't think there's much more else that should be said.
I don't know if it's a question for Rich or for you, but in 2008, the agreement was amended, and it still included paragraph 7, which is the reimbursement provision. Then 2013, that paragraph was deleted. Why?
Give the library an opportunity to make a decision whether they wanted to pay it or not. And I think really when we looked at that agreement, whether or not that was even legal to have them.
First I have to say I wasn't involved in the amendment and restatement due to conflict situations.
Because
in 2008,
not 2013.
But the purpose in 2008 was to get some provisions. It wasn't looking really at the entire agreement. It was to get some provisions on how, if there were to be a building project or acquiring a building, to get some provisions in the agreement on that, that that would require a capital project agreement, that all the municipalities would have to agree. There was verbiage on impact fees, use of impact fees and how those would be used. So that was the purpose of looking at the agreement again. It wasn't, I wasn't involved in looking at it, but I don't think they looked at it as a whole. I think they were looking at it for that specific purpose. And that's really what they did. They added those provisions. And then I believe in the county made a change, again, without, I don't believe, contacting or notifying the municipalities that, or at least the joint library, that they would raise reimbursement rates to 100%, which affected the amounts that the library, joint library, would pay. So I guess the short answer is I don't think they were looking at the agreement for that purpose.
Okay.
The reason it came up in 2013 was partially because the funding issue with the increase to 100% was a problem. And also with the new building and so forth, it just, the library was having difficulties, and at that funding difficulties, and at that point we did look at the joint library agreement and that provision, and took the position that it can be changed, it's allowed under the agreement. And now, after looking at it more carefully, under the statute, I don't even believe that provision was authorized, because it was an agreement amongst the municipal governing bodies telling the library board how they had to spend their money. And under Wisconsin statutes, the library board has the exclusive authority. The municipalities decide on level of funding within the statutory parameters, but they cannot tell the library board how to spend the money that's appropriated to them. So, and just looking back at it, perhaps if you noticed in the county attorney's opinion that I provided, that was an opinion to the county board, but he graciously gave me a copy of it. He noted that their approval was not conditional on that provision being in the agreement. They noted that that was the intent, but the county likewise doesn't have any authority to tell a library board how to spend money that's appropriated to that library board. The library board has the exclusive authority to make that decision. So my opinion is that it would not be appropriate to have an agreement like that, at least in the only participation that the city has is in the joint library agreement. So my opinion is that provision wasn't authorized to begin with,
and
we can't go back. I would advise against going back. You'd be putting in something that's not legally authorized.
And to clarify county's corporate counsel memo that you sent us, and the proverbial hammer hanging over another municipality, their corporate counsel's telling us that that does not exist for them to go after us. It says, you know, cannot require the library to pay for the 2014 reimbursements and lacks the authority to rescind any of approval.
Correct.
So basically, this is a moot point. Would you?
Well, in my opinion, yeah, it is a moot point as to going back. The statutes don't require, I think Mr. O'Connor is correct, other libraries who levy a tax on their own residents to operate a library are paying to support other municipalities' libraries. That's just not how the statute is set up.
Well, to be fair, and I've heard a lot, and I would just like to say that to be fair to this process, to go back to the original agreement, legal or not, the intent was, and after talking to a couple of other librarians as part of the system, that when St. Joseph asked Somerset, hey, should we do this? Somerset said, well, we don't know. And then who was the original president of the?
Jim O'Connor.
Jim O'Connor.
Came and talked.
No relation.
To, What's that?
No relation. It's not like there's a dynasty over there, library going on right now.
There's a couple of O'Connors.
Contingent.
Railroad builders, yeah. So that they went and presented them no less than four times to say, hey, the reason you should sign up for this is that we're going to put this in here that the Joint Library Board would in fact reimburse or basically take over as the agent of the rural recirculation. That's clear to me. That's clear to them. I've talked to a couple of the people. So we're all sitting around and you say, well, you guys are going to take all the money, but instead of the county giving you the rural funds back, these guys are. I finally understand how this all came to be. It's been very confusing to me and I wanted to give it kind of its due diligence. It's kind of a good old boy agreement, but in reality, the intent was still there. And as Tom points out, back in 2008, when they re-amended it, that agreement to recirculate funds, the Joint Library Board as the agent instead of the county was still in effect. So all this time, these other libraries that normally would have got funded from the recirculation fee were getting the money from the Joint Library Board. And now after the recent amendment, when we took that out, Somerset no longer gets, let's just say $10,000, because all the people from St. Joseph that go there don't have to pay because they're exempt for part of the deal. So it was kind of a gentleman's agreement going forward, whether it's lock, stock, legal or not. It sounds like it's not. That was the intent of the original agreement. Like it or not, that's how it went. And now we've sort of rescinded that gentleman's agreement on behalf of the Joint Library holding on to the money. You know, it's kind of a weird deal, and I don't necessarily share the whole notion of voting and the dog track and the library and all that. I just think that we've kind of gone out of our way now to say we are not going to recirculate those funds. Whether or not people are willing to change their mind on that, I really don't know. But I finally understand that's what happened. Mm-hmm. It was always the honest intent of the library board to be fair, to be the agent of the recirculation of the rural funds. So when we as a council went ahead and talked about it, and Neil did a great job sharing how the money went over, I still didn't understand that this was the original intent of the agreement. I probably would have voted no on that just because I believe that I know they can be exempt. However, it's proven that they save a ton of money by being part of this program and wouldn't get nearly as much in the recirculation anyway. So I don't know if I really have a point, but the gentleman's agreement is what people are upset about. Other people that do favor that, and you know, I'm tempted to make a motion to go back, but we would require all the other libraries to vote and to make that happen. Is that correct?
All yes. The municipalities.
Yeah.
All the municipalities that are part of it.
Are you looking for a formal action?
No, I thought we could. I think last meeting he said let's bring it back and talk about it more. John, I'll take one other side of that. And, you know, we were, at the time when this, in 2008, we were getting 70% reimbursement rate. And they switched it to 100. They didn't ask us. They didn't tell us. They just went ahead and did it. So what happened to that gentleman's agreement?
No, I understand. Yeah.
So what I'm, my issue on this is we've got a county library, or county board telling our library, not us, how much they should send to other libraries. And the statute doesn't allow that. The money that comes to the library has got to be controlled by the library board. We allocate money. We can't tell them where to send the money or spend the money. What we did is they still have a right to do that if they want to send the money out. But we're struggling to try and operate our library and trying to get it open on Mondays. You know, I try push very nicely and to try and get that open again, but you know, it's their choice. We can't make them open it on Monday. But
so Al?
Yep.
So you said the county board took an action and that
they had a right to take the action.
Yeah, and this amendment was a reaction to that action.
No. That amendment, no. That happened 2 years, 3 or 4 years later.
But it changed the funding position of the library.
And it made our library get less money.
Yeah. What was the net dollar effect of that county decision?
Does Neil know?
Neil, do you know off the top of your head? Our reimbursement rate is about 235, or back then it was 235 or 245.
230 something right now. It's a little bit under $3.
Yep.
But I mean, the one thing when the county, right around when the county they had an increase from 70% to 85%, then up to 100. There were a couple steps in there.
Yep.
And the 1 year there was a large reimbursement to the other library was a transition year when we were moving into the new building.
Yep.
And that was right around when we had these steps going on.
How much do you think that was? Do you remember?
In that transition year, our library paid out in excess of $50,000.
So, I mean, that was a big excess money. That was a big amount for us.
And there was also 1 year where the city taxpayers paid an additional amount on their tax bills, correct, Neil?
Correct.
Because of the way the certification went.
Right, because we're not exempt under state statute from the county library.
So we paid a tax to the library, or to the county for the library, and we paid, in the city taxes, we paid for the library.
Right, and based upon our mill rate, we probably paid half the county library levy.
Yeah, so we paid twice that 1 year, but then they changed some of the...
That was a state law change that allowed it.
State law change, and then we went back to just paying it through our taxes.
I can honestly say that, knowing what people know now, they never would have agreed to endorse the joint library at the time when it occurred. So I guess it's kind of one of those deals where, you know, governments change, people change, and there it is. So we can either...
You think we should try and go back and get our money back?
You know, I don't know.
No, I'm not trying to be...
I know you're not. I just wanted to honestly know up front that this is what actually happened, because up till now, everyone, it's kind of been a crisscross of information, including the last time I voted yes for the resolution. I still did not get this picture. So I think it's fair to at least have the conversation.
This is the, from what other people, you know, there's the other side of the, there's always two sides to every story on it. And, you know, for the county to say, if you pay this money, we'll approve it, I don't think that's legal to do that, to say that, because now you're dictating dollars on how they're spent. So, yeah, you may have an agreement, a gentleman's agreement, but was it even legal to do it back? And again, that's water over the dam, and that's gone.
Sure.
So, you know.
A bunch of people at the time said, yeah, this just seems like a good deal.
Yeah.
That's what happened. So.
And the issue, like you said, and I believe that's true, is we'll approve this deal only if we get this money. Well, again, you're dictating what a library should pay, and I don't think they had any right or legally to be able to do that. Either they should have said yes or no.
Well, it's like asking your constituents, right? You know,
yep.
Kind of the same deal.
Yep.
So I don't know if I have any more to say. Even if we made a motion to go back,
I've got a few thoughts that I'd like to express here. You know, what are our options? Do we have, and then also, how do we respond to the county? Because I think that it does require some type of response. So what is our option there? But one thing that that keeps coming back to me is, how does this affect the perception of Hudson's integrity? And if we're going to be asking our neighbors to help us in the future, how will this affect our relationship with them? And I don't have answers. That's why I'm asking the questions.
I'll try and answer that. I think it was answered, quite frankly, by the librarian from Somerset, who said, you guys have a lot of money and we don't, so give us more money. That is total BS as far as I'm concerned. And the integrity has nothing to do with integrity. It has treating people fair and treating our own taxpayers the right way, in my opinion. And I don't see any reason why we should spend money to other libraries who get, each of the municipalities we're talking about get more state aid than we do. So is that fair? We should get more state aid. I mean, you can argue circles around who gets what, or was it integrity to lower our amount or raise the reimbursement rate without even asking us, just go ahead and do it? And they did it in steps, which, you know, it happened. And so where's the integrity? And what do we mean? I guess I would like to know how they've helped us out. I mean, what have they done for us? I mean, you're saying, how are they going to help us out? I don't understand that question, Joyce.
Well, I'm just, you know, neighbors help each other out,
right.
and there might be some time when we need some help from our neighbors. You know, I don't have any specific examples. I'm just...
Well, can I just point out, Hudson does a really good job of cooperating with its neighbors. It's got the fire department where it contracts mm-hmm. with its neighbors. It's created a commission, fire commission, that has members from the participating municipalities, so they can have input and make budget recommendations and really have a hands-on approach. Does the same thing for the emergency medical services. It's created, it provides the service, it finances it, a lot of the, you know, the big ticket items, but it's also created a commission, again, that includes the appoint, members from the other governing bodies. So, you know, I just think that argument doesn't hold water. I think what happened is that people did not understand the funding system at the time the original agreement was put in place.
Well, and I think it was, I think it was short-sighted in, on that. The original agreement, I think it was short-sighted in not having a sunset clause.
Yeah, correct. And I mean, I just don't think it's, I just think this, you know, not good to its neighbors is just not a correct argument. As far as options, I don't, my legal opinion is you can't go back. That provision was not authorized to begin with. As far as the Common Council and the other governing bodies, the library agreement is where, you know, is the part where the council and the governing bodies participate. And it wouldn't make sense to go back to a provision that never should have been there.
So how do we respond to the county?
Well, I would say to the county that we are putting the system back on the footing that it's supposed to have under the statute, that each community in the joint library system levies a tax on its own residents to support a library. The statutes don't require or even contemplate reimbursement among libraries that whose residents pay a tax towards their own library. So there's no reason to treat the Hudson Area Joint Library any differently from the River Falls Library, the Somerset Library, the Roberts Library, because those residents pay a tax to support their library. And so the funding for the library should stay within the communities that pay that tax. And all the city and the member municipalities are doing is being consistent with state statute. It went, at the very beginning, that provision was not consistent with state statute. So why should the county treat the Hudson Area Joint Library any different from River Falls? I would make the legal argument that the county's decisions need to have some rational basis, and that it's arbitrary for them to punish Hudson Area Joint Library when the changes that have been made have been done to bring it back consistent with the statutory system. And we can't go back. That's wasting time and energy. What you can do is make sure you do the best for your library and let the county board know that this is consistent with the statute, and you know, that's, they should treat the city and the Hudson Area Joint Library consistently. There's just no basis for reducing it to 70%.
Joyce, you have anything else you'd like to?
Well, is there, are there any legal way, is there anything legal that we could do to get the county to reimburse us at 100%? Or is,
well,
is that,
I mean,
their prerogative?
I don't think there's anything in the law that prohibits, you know, specifically says you have to reimburse all your municipal libraries at the same rate. And in fact, there are other counties that have a different rate for some libraries. I don't know the basis for that. I mean, why those counties chose to do that. So I don't think you can say it's, you know, plain and simply unlawful. But I think the argument would be it's arbitrary, because what the city and the member municipalities have done is bring the library back into operating consistently with the state statute. I think, you know, there's law and there's politics, and I think you need to explain. I think they've heard the wrong story, frankly, the county board members. And I think, I mean, granted that provision was in there, but the story that Hudson doesn't treat its neighbors properly is not correct. I think the provision was based on a misunderstanding or lack of understanding on the part of all parties.
I think, to be slightly corrective, that they knew exactly what they were doing, and they sold it to a bunch of people, got the agreement done, and so it went for quite some time, until we finally amended it. This paying people out, acting as the agent for the recirculation of rural funds, the Joint Library Board, they did that knowing full well that they needed support to get the Joint Library done, politically,
well,
not legally. And I think what you said earlier was right, that, you know, it just wasn't really something you could do, but it was done anyway. It was done for a long time.
Yep.
But can I also say this, because I do believe that, and rightly or wrongly, the library board chair, who does not speak on behalf of the governing body and has no authority, went to some of these municipalities, and that was almost outside the control of the federal body.
I said four times.
All I'm saying
not
is,
you.
No, the former.
Yes.
At the
time.
The
other O'Connor.
You know, one person should not bind the council and the governing bodies. And in any event, what's past is past. And I think you do need to move forward, but I do think the county needs to hear a different side of the
Catherine,
story.
Now, if I understand correctly, the bottom line is that the taxpayers of Hudson have no legal responsibility to pay anything other than what they're paying for their library. Is that right?
Correct.
Okay, thanks.
Yeah, we have our own library, right? So we're exempt from,
As long as you stay within the, in fact, each municipality stays within the funding requirements of the state law.
I think a well-crafted letter from council and the mayor in regards to reaffirming our position due to us by the state statute would suffice where we stand.
Well, we'll, you know, they haven't made a motion. They have not done anything on this yet.
It's only in subcommittee.
Yep.
Yeah.
Well, this is just kind of preemptive in a response.
I think we should
wait. What do we say?
I think we want more input. I mean, I want, Rich, did you have anything else you wanted to?
You know, I think it's all been said. I will maybe conclude my comments with this. I think that there was a misunderstanding, or I don't know about a misunderstanding, but certainly not a complete understanding on the part of the library board exactly how this all came about. And I would say that we probably did not communicate our intentions as best as we probably could have, and when we made that decision. And I take responsibility for that. I think we could have done a better job of explaining to our neighbors, to our friends out there, why we were doing this, that we were put in a position that we really had to.
Okay.
Where did the original, the change to no longer reimburse where did that originate?
From with me.
So you were the one who started
the
conversation.
Mr. Mayor,
okay.
if I may, I'm not sure exactly where this originated, but I did go back into minutes, board minutes and finance committee minutes. And in fact, it was discussed in finance committee by Mr. Schoberg when he chaired the finance committee. It was raised, and I have no idea who raised it. I have no idea where it came in, but I believe the minutes went back to 2012, where this was discussed as an option. It was rejected at the time by the Finance Committee, but it was brought forward to the board as an option.
What I was trying to do was get more funding for our library, which it desperately needed at the time, and we need more And so that was the rationale, and as we looked at the agreement, item seven?
Yes.
Paragraph seven.
We did research on it, and quite frankly, I don't think it was, in my opinion, and legal, was that we can't do that. We can't force them to, but we'll give them the option, which they have an option to do and not do, because we can't tell them what to do with their money.
Okay.
So we gave them an option. So I'll take responsibility or blame, or however you want to put it, for doing that.
The
intention was to get more money for our library.
The other thing that I'm hearing, or I've heard from the other libraries, is because we're closed on Mondays, that does put pressure on the other libraries. For example, one of the librarians did say that because they've got programs on Mondays, and so then the library director has to be at the front desk when she would prefer to be doing library director jobs, and they don't have the money to hire a part-time person because they no longer have this reimbursement.
Joyce, and I think that was at Roberts, right?
I think so.
Yeah, between December, June, and December of 2013 to June, December of 2014, there was 52 people in the entire year more on a Monday than there was the year, previous year. So there was one a week.
Okay.
And in Somerset, the numbers actually went down. Mm-hmm. There was less people at the Somerset Library. And New Richmond also went down 600 people during the year. River Falls went up almost 1,500. So River Falls went up, the others went down.
Okay.
So, yes, sir.
Mr. Mayor and council members, it's a very interesting point, council member Hall. Right home. Sorry about that.
Alderperson. That's my official title.
Alderperson, really?
Yes.
Okay. Sorry about that. If I had been invited into that hearing, I would have let them all know that at the top of our agenda was to reopen the library on Mondays. and we were fully anticipating doing that, and then all of a sudden we heard that they were debating whether to take us back to the 70% funding level, so that really kind of put us in a bad spot. But we would have told them, if things stay the same right now, we'll be open on Monday in no time flat. But
okay, so that needs to be communicated.
Yeah.
How much?
It was my understanding that wasn't the primary issue. I mean, it was the repayment agreement was the primary issue.
Right, but this might be a way of improving the relationships. Mm-hmm. Would be to, so how much would it cost annually to open the library on Mondays?
You know, I can't remember. I think, Neil, do you remember what the number? We looked at this and you provided me, pardon me?
I don't recall.
You know, essentially all it is personnel.
Right. I mean, do you have a ballpark? I mean, is it?
Why don't you get back to us on this?
Sure.
Okay.
Yeah.
It's like
we've got budgeting coming up.
Yep.
I think that's an important discussion that we should have during budgeting.
Yep.
I think it's less than 20,000, isn't it?
I'm thinking in the $20,000 to $30,000 range.
Okay. It's not that bad, and we've had some significant savings. I mean, I must say that the tool that was provided us to not pay the our surrounding communities allowed us to balance our budget. We were at a point where we were $100,000 deficits, and in the year that we took the vote to stop the payments to our neighboring libraries, we were at $56,000 deficit. That brought it down significantly. There are some other things. I think we lost a staff member that we didn't replace that put us at a balanced budget for the first time in years, and so we now have had a chance to. After everything was cut, trimmed down, now we need to get back. Mondays are at the top of our list.
Anything else?
I really appreciate the opportunity to get the whole story, because up until now, I just didn't have it. It didn't make sense, but now it makes complete sense, because a lot of people got together and got creative up front, whether it was legal or not, and then we fixed it. So
we tried to fix it.
Apparently, that's where we're at.
Well, I'd just like to make one more comment.
Sure.
And one is that I did get a copy of the strategic plan, and the the supplement to it, and so it is in there to open on Mondays. And the biggest thing is increasing funding in whatever way is possible through the foundation or through the Friends, well, through a combination of all three, the public entities, municipalities. So anyway, I just wanted to say that I thought that this, I appreciated the strategic plan. I thought it was well thought out, and there's a lot of information in there that is important.
Good.
If I remember, the if the county goes ahead with their 70% penalty for the Hudson, it's a $25,000 to $30,000 impact.
21, Neil.
21.
24. 24. Excuse me. 24.
It's about what we need in order.
There goes Monday. Yeah.
That's exactly right.
There goes Monday. Yeah. Okay. Anything else? Thank you very much. We'll keep this as we get into the budget process, and thanks for your input. I mean, I think it's John, and it was good comments. Thank you, Rich.
Members. Appreciate it.
Yep. All right. New business. Discussion. Possible action on Ordinance 8-15, Ordinance amending the City Code Chapter 124-5H. Neil or Devin?
Basically, this is just a cleanup to correct. It's not changing the code. It's just changing the statutory reference. State statute number change. So this is just so we match up with the state statute number.
This is in reference to what ordinance?
The direct seller's permit.
Okay.
It just talks about, you know, what they have to do to get a license, that type of thing. Correct, Nancy?
Correct.
That's what. And basically, it used to be Section 440, and now it's Section 202.
Okay.
Move to suspend the rules.
Is there a second?
Second.
Roll call.
Weber?
Yes.
McCormick?
Yes.
Morissette?
Yes.
Hall?
Yes.
Hoggett?
Yes.
Is there a motion to approve Ordinance 8-15?
So move.
Chapter Code 124.
Second.
Okay. Discussion? All those in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Opposed? Communication for future agenda items. City Council people, any items that you'd like to see on the agenda? City Attorney?
Nope.
Any comments? City Administrator?
The next meeting is on Tuesday, September 8th. Because Monday is Labor Day, so it'll be on the 8th. Agendas will still go out on Friday, but.
Just a comment. Good discussion tonight on the library. It's good to get out and let's talk about these things,
yeah,
and
share
them out in the open. So is there a motion to adjourn?
So moved.
Is there a second?
I'll second.
All those in favor?
Aye.
We're adjourned. Thank you.